Thank you very much, Maria Antonietta. The title of my talk today is Papal Court Global Goods, Rome as a Center of Global Economic Exchanges between the 16th and 18th centuries. That is to say, the following paper will address the important role that members of the Papal Court played as collectors, distributors, and consumers of commodities from both East and West during what is often dubbed the First Global Age. John Darwin has observed the emergence of new intercontinental networks, which was the defining feature of this phase in globalization's history. And the Catholic Church was very much in the vanguard of such activity. The Church's networks transported Catholic Christianity abroad and brought luxury goods back home. All types of luxury goods, sugar, dyes, feathers, chocolate, tobacco, and other plants from the Americas, coffee, textiles, porcelain, animals, and botanical specimens from Asia, they all arrived in Rome during these centuries. But what was different about Rome compared to other centers of European commerce and trade at this time? My starting point for this paper is that there were four differences. First, the Papal Court's leading members enjoyed a higher concentration of wealth than many other local elites. Second, they not only had wealth, but had also often received educations which specifically incentivized them to develop eclectic and exotic tastes. Thirdly, their own status within Catholic society gave them disproportionate influence over the tastes of others. And fourth, in the Catholic Church, they had a supply chain unparalleled amongst secular organizations, which employed a broad range of intermediaries with considerable specialist knowledge of how to act as brokers, including with non-Christians. For all these reasons, the Papal Court seems to me to have been one of the most significant sites of early modern global exchanges. It wouldn't be fair to say that this observation is entirely original, for many historians and art historians, including Maria Antonietta Visceglia, who is here with us today, have engaged aspects of it, in some cases quite extensively. The purpose of my paper, then, is in part to synthesize and in part to organize their findings. In particular, I aim to propose categories for thinking about papal engagement with extra-European produce and with the effects of that engagement. As a topic in the story of the global papacy, the subject of today's gathering, this may seem less pivotal than some other topics. The rise of the Propaganda Fide and its role in Christianity's global spread, the Curia's role in governing the global church, or even the Pope's role in forging diplomatic norms and networks. Yet my contention here is that we need to think holistically about the papacy's impact and to assemble the broadest case we can for why it, and by extension the rest of the Catholic Church, fits into global history. With that in mind, I want to sketch out the current state of knowledge and suggest lines of inquiry for advancing it. I think my discussion is representative of the issues and challenges that face global historians as they study the Catholic Church, but also of those that face ecclesiastical historians as we think about the papacy's wider cultural impact. The starting point of my discussion then has got to be who and what. Who were the members of the Papal Court who participated in the new patterns of global circulation of luxury goods, and what kinds of goods interested them? The most obvious participants in this activity were popes themselves, and they consumed and collected goods brought to them as gifts. Pius IV is said to have been one of, if not the first Italians, to try a potato sent to him as a medicinal product by Philip of Spain. Clement VIII performed a similar role in popularizing coffee amongst Catholics. Advised against trying it because it was an Islamic beverage and, quote, a bitter invention of Satan, Clement came up with one of his trademark jokes. This Satan's drink is so delicious, he said, that it would be a pity to let the infidels have exclusive use of it. But popes, though considerable in number, especially during the 16th century, only constitute a small group of those within the papal court who engaged with extra-European products. Cardinals, who numbered around 1,200 individuals during this period, were just as active in procuring and in consuming. Indeed, they were often more so because they operated under conditions of greater liberty. The same might also be said of lesser curial prelates, who were even more numerous, but whose interests have attracted still less attention. Certainly, there is much piecemeal research into specific cardinals and their tastes. Equally, there are now many studies of the history of particular goods, which mention cardinals en passant. These studies often confirm not only what cardinals collected and consumed, but also give us clues about why they did so. They let us begin to piece together how cardinals' activities fit into the wider history of how particular commodities were consumed. And around 50 to 100 cardinals can demonstrably be shown to have taken part in this consumption just based on the secondary literature available. Unsurprisingly, in most cases, each of these cardinals collected or consumed far more than just one type of luxury good. For example, Cardinal Richelieu, a cardinal though not a curialist, took particular interest in tea and chocolate, but also bequeathed Louis XIII 400 pieces of Chinese porcelain. Curial cardinals often had more modest collections. However, even one like the Tuscan Giovanni Ricci, a client of Alessandro Farnese Juniore, is known to have collected not only Chinese porcelain and Oriental scrolls, but also Indian furniture, parrots, and rare breeds of cat. But even these Italian cardinals had varied tastes, which reflected both the changing availability of goods over this period and also wider European fashions in consuming them. That in itself suggests to me there is a lot more out there to be discovered about them, and I will return to the ways in which we might do that in the later part of my talk. What drove cardinals and curial prelates to collect or consume extra-European goods in this period? And how did their motives differ from those of secular elites? The answers to these questions are crucial to my argument. Historians have often explained secular elites' interest in extra-European goods as the result of one or more of the following. First, curiosity, which stimulated collecting. Second, the status which they gained from displaying acquisitions or presenting them as gifts. Third, the fact that they enjoyed consuming these goods. And fourth, that they consumed them for medical or medicinal reasons. Early modern popes and cardinals demonstrably shared all of these motivations for consuming or collecting non-European goods, and we can show several documented examples for each. Silvio Valenti Gonzaga, Secretary of State to Benedict XIV, enjoyed eating pineapples, which he grew at his Roman villa, where they were probably the first pineapples grown in Italy. Several 18th century popes were keen chocolate drinkers. Benedict XIII used it to revive himself after the arduous ceremonies of Easter 1725, whilst Benedict XIV drank it daily. The cardinals took it as a sign that Clement XII was reaching the end when he could no longer imbibe his daily drink of chocolate at the end of January 1740, and Clement died on the 6th of February. Pier Paolo Crescenzi was said to have taught Urban VIII to take snuff medicinally too. Turning to status signalling, one way that Alessandro Farnese Juniore and Odoardo Farnese asserted their wealth and connections was through the collection of botanic specimens in the Orti Farnesiani. Francesco Barberini and Fabio Chigi did the same through the zoos that they maintained in their Roman villas. Several later cardinals sought a claim from their collections of Oriental artifacts. Others, including Carlo Borromeo, Lorenzo Strozzi, Ferdinando de' Medici, and Gabriele Paleotti, owned examples of Mexican featherwork, either images made from feathers, as on the right here, or mitres made from them, as on the left. In the 1590s, Alessandro de' Medici displayed one of the earliest European tapestries dyed with bright red cochineal. In the 1620s, Antonio Barberini sported one of the earliest clerical vestments prepared with the substance. Further investigation would doubtless yield plenty more cases of cardinals acting as early adopters for all these reasons. However, cardinals also had one further reason for collecting and or consuming above and beyond secular elites. We might term this an instrumental religious motivation. Historians have documented this in various cases. Barbara Kahl, for example, attributes to this the different emphases of Francesco de' Medici and his brother, the Cardinal Ferdinando, in the shopping lists that they sent to the family's supplier in India, the Florentine merchant Filippo Sassetti, in the 1580s. Donald Lach saw it in Marcello Cervini's acquisitions of Chinese manuscripts in the 1550s. Both these historians drew on a wider consensus that many within this first generation of Counter-Reformation clerics were especially interested in looking outwards and in collecting artifacts for the information they yielded, information which, as we've heard from Federico, would be useful in their efforts to evangelize all peoples. One thing we now have to consider is how long that particular motive lasted and how it fits with the other motives. And how exactly did cardinals and curialists think their acquisition in Rome of certain goods would help the missionary efforts elsewhere? There is still much to be investigated here through the archives of the Propaganda Fide. But popes and cardinals may have consumed or collected for many of the same reasons as princes and secular elites. However, how they did so was not necessarily the same, either qualitatively or quantitatively. Prima facie, we ought to expect the Pope and cardinals should have found it easier to obtain global produce than members of secular elites for at least three reasons. First, they had far better access to one of the principal networks for obtaining production from non-European societies, that is, the Catholic Church itself. Religious orders went to Mexico, Peru, Brazil, Africa, India, even China and Japan. Every one of them had a cardinal protector who was often in regular contact, not just with the order's minister general, but with specific members who were interested in his activities and whom he chose to patronize. We've also heard already about the role of procurators coming to Rome. A mid-17th century English account almost certainly claims that goods regularly reached Rome via these methods. The first chapter of this decidedly anti-papal work is entitled How Rome Doth Yearly Visit the American and Asian Kingdoms. Its author, Thomas Gage, claims that, quote, procurators from the religious orders carry with them great wealth and gifts to the generals, to the popes and cardinals and nobles in Spain, as bribes to facilitate whatsoever just or unjust, right or wrong, they are to demand. Secondly, all curial clerics potentially benefited from the clergy's unique privilege of sending and receiving gifts duty-free from port to port within the Spanish Empire. Goods destined for ecclesiastical institutions were the only ones on which the crown did not levy avaria taxes. Antonio Díaz Rodríguez has noted how Spanish friars and priests were amongst the most enthusiastic purchasers of Chinese silks, which they then used either for fashioning chasubles and robes or for dressing statues of the Virgin and saints. So it's far from inconceivable that much of this material ended up adorning churches or prelates in Rome. A third advantage curial clerics had over many members of secular elites in their quest for exotic goods was that almost uniquely, they could build connections with traders from across the imperial or commercial networks of all Catholic societies. That is to say, Venetians and Genoese in the Eastern Mediterranean, and Spaniards and Portuguese and Frenchmen in the Atlantic world and Asia. Members of secular elites could also do this, but were potentially more encumbered by different rivalries amongst the various Catholic sovereigns. when France and Spain were at war, that typically limited trade between the nobility of one state and the mercantile classes of the other. The Roman couriers' networks, by contrast, operated more or less across all Catholic societies. Rome was therefore likely an important final destination for both American and Asian goods. However, little archival work has been done on the inventories of individual cardinals and lesser prelates, nor has anyone worked on the surviving records of the Manila and Veracruz galleons, investigating how many of the goods they conveyed were directed onto Rome. At the moment, all we have to verify the trade flows are a few incidental records. Juan de Lugo, made a cardinal by Urban VIII in 1643, for example, is widely credited with promoting the medicinal use of cinchona bark after he was presented with some by the Jesuit Bartolome Tafur, who visited Rome from Peru in 1645. Jesuits certainly also supplied Eduardo Farnese with botanical specimens from Asia for his gardens. But a short letter from Cardinal Francesco del Monte to the Grand Duke of Tuscany confirms that he in turn passed them on to others around Italy. Mando qui in un scatolino alcuni fagioli venuti dall'India di Portogallo al Cardinale Farnese, e le ho promesso non ne dare a veruno eccetto a vostra altezza. Questi fanno tanta ombra che coprono una cerchiata più abbondantemente che non fanno le zucche. To recapitulate, in many cases, establishing that popes and or cardinals were early adopters of a particular European, or sorry, extra-European product is not that difficult. The hard part is in assessing how their willingness to adopt global wares shaped wider patterns of collecting or consumption within Europe. Perhaps self-evidently, we cannot easily quantify this impact, but we can, to garble a much loathed phrase from our beloved UK Research Council, identify some of its principal pathways. The first and most obvious pathway to impact was as trendsetters, that is, people whose early adoption of certain products led the way for others to adopt them too. There are various documented instances where curial clerics seem to have performed this function and where others either adopted a product because a cardinal had done so or, and this is the more important case, they used curial sanction as part of their marketing. The figure of the Pope and of cardinals were powerful brands in the 17th and 18th centuries, and so it's not totally surprising that the portrayers of such products would have wished to associate them with the Roman Curia. Remember, for example, Leo XIII's famous endorsement of cocaine-flavored wine in the 1890s. It remains a big problem in the secondary literature on comestibles, that is, tobacco, chocolate, coffee, and so on, that the desire to have cardinals involved in the story means that an awful lot of curial clerics who were not, in fact, of the purple gained status promotions in the telling. However, the earliest instance I have found where a product was expressly associated with a cardinal comes in Castro Durante's Herbario Nuovo in 1585. Durante credits Prospero Santa Croce, who had been nuncio in Spain and Portugal under Pius IV, with having introduced the plant into Italy. Durante commemorates this with a short Latin verse. Our forebears once the Holy Cross did bring, the boon of every nation, but Cross's house is now the famous dwelling for our bodies and our souls' salvation. Other examples I have encountered also tend to involve food. David Gentilcore has drawn our attention to the fact that Antonio Barberini's chef, Antonio Latini, is the first known to have used tomatoes in European cuisine, although Gentilcore does not fully elaborate on how important Barberini's patronage was to the fruit's adoption at other Italian tables. Lorenzo Magalotti, who imported Spanish tastes in chocolate to Italy in the late 17th century, did so via a recipe book which purported to have been written by Cardinal de Moncada. As I said, the important thing is not so much whether these stories about clerics and their tastes are true, indeed there must be a good chance that most of them are apocryphal, but that contemporaries believed popes and cardinals to have been instrumental in the spread of new tastes, or at least saw value in trying to present them as having been. Popes and cardinals also had a second pathway to impact. Rather than encouraging others to consume particular goods, sometimes they helped to circulate them merely by owning them, and thus maintaining their availability to others. Here the members of the Curia were less trendsetters than market makers. This was certainly the case with botanical specimens. Although Leo X founded Italy's first chair in botany at La Sapienza in 1514, in general, popes were slower than princes elsewhere to encourage the systematic study of plants. Popes and cardinals cultivated exotic plants in Rome primarily to exert status or to use them medicinally on themselves. However, Rome had one of the best climates for growing tropical plants, and once plants were established in cardinals' gardens, third parties could observe them scientifically or harvest cuttings or seeds from them, which they then took elsewhere. Odoardo Farnese's collections in the Orti Farnesiani form the basis of a well-known study by Pietro Castelli, which documents and provides drawings of some 16 exotic specimens grown exclusively there. One, the Acacia Farnesiana, derives its name from the gardens, but the others Castelli studied include a yucca, a passion flower, an amaryllis, an aloe, and a Peruvian bindweed. Not only did Castelli record the growth, flowering, and fruiting habits of these plants in some detail, but he may also have used them as a source for the plants at the new botanic garden he founded in Messina in 1631. In 1640, Castelli published a second treatise about that garden, the Hortus Messiensis, which he dedicated to Francesco Barberini. In fact, by this time, Barberini's own private flower garden, a project which seems to have been intended to rival the Orti Farnesiani, was also providing resources to early botanists and naturalists. The Vatican Library preserves several tracts and treatises written on the basis of information gathered there, an anonymous Botanologica Esotica, and several works by Francesco Mingucci de Pesaro, Trattazione della coltivazione di alcuni fiori, Trattato della coltivazione di alcuni fiori gelsomini e delle rosse doppie, fiore diverse coloriti dal naturale, and uccelli diversi coloriti dal naturale. Connections between curial clerics and other naturalists in Italy are known, but not necessarily fully explored. For example, Ulisse Aldovrandi, who established the botanic gardens in Bologna, established a close friendship with Cardinal Tournon's doctor in the 1550s and was a lifelong friend of Gabriele Paleotti, the Archbishop, from 1567. A final area in which the papal curia played an important part in shaping wider tastes was its special role in regulating consumption in Catholic societies, often on religious grounds. It could, of course, also shape it in Protestant societies too, albeit unwittingly. Oliver Cromwell famously refused to take cinchona bark when he was lying ill in 1658 because it was known in England at the time as cardinal's powder. However, we can also find a number of examples where popes or cardinals intervened directly in questions about the ethics of consuming the new extra-European products. The pair of papal bulls by which Urban VIII and Innocent X prohibited the use of tobacco in churches in Seville in 1642 and in Rome in 1650 are perhaps the best known. However, both Gregory XIII and later Cardinal Francesco Maria Brancaccio were also asked to make rulings about chocolate too, specifically on the question of whether consuming it broke the fast. The Jesuits, who were major financiers of cocoa plantations in Central America, promoted the view that it did not. The Dominicans opposed them because they always opposed the Jesuits. Marcy Norton has noted how the theological controversies which grew up around both tobacco and chocolate in the late 17th century in fact reflected wider currents within the Counter-Reformation, in particular debates about how to renew and revitalize the clergy and how to assert the mystical sanctity of holy places. This resulted in two points of contention in the case of tobacco. Firstly, did consuming it interfere with communion? And second, was its use by holy people or in holy places sacrilegious? In the case of chocolate, the narrow question about its material status and thus its suitability for use in the fast also stood as a proxy for broader ones. What was its social role to be, and did it have preternatural or supernatural qualities? Its Jesuit promoters and Dominican detractors in New Spain often likened it respectively to either a Eucharistic elixir or a witch's unguent. However, when a Dominican approached Gregory XIII in 1577, the Pope and cardinals apparently found his request so trivial that they burst out laughing. Gregory would not give an official ruling on the permissibility of consuming chocolate, only an oral verdict. But Ancaccio's written treatise came only 100 years later, no doubt under strong pressure from the Jesuits who had educated him in Naples. Certainly, the Jesuits were sufficiently pleased with what Brancaccio had written that they printed his text 5 times between 1664 and 1676. And the original 1664 edition includes a rather striking ode to the cocoa tree, written by a Spanish Jesuit. In 1725, Benedict XIII repealed Innocent X's edict of 1650, which suggests that, however sound the theology behind it, prohibition of tobacco in church or amongst the clergy was both unenforceable and resented. Moreover, we know that several 18th century popes used tobacco enthusiastically, which raises an interesting question about whether the two phenomena were related. Did Benedict and other 18th century popes relax ecclesiastical sanctions against New World drugs because they enjoyed them themselves, or was their willingness to smoke or take snuff merely a sign of spreading fashions? My overall conclusion to this paper, then, is that the Catholic Church in general, and the Roman Curia in particular, played a much more important role in the history of consumption than we might first think, and certainly a far more substantial role in the circulation of goods than Protestant ministers and churches did in Northern Europe. I hope this paper has also raised a number of points of specific interest. For me, what I've said highlights certain yet unanswered questions. How far can we reconstruct habits and patterns of consumption within the Curia? How do they relate to those within the wider church? How did the Curia's influence within Italy compare to that outside it? And what might Curial clerics' demonstrable habits in consuming certain goods tell us about their theological positions and interests? The spread of chocolate and tobacco through the papal court may also tell us much about how Roman clerics internalized the discovery of a world outside Europe as their evolving interest. It may tell us as much about how Roman clerics internalized the discovery of a world outside Europe as their evolving interest in the evangelization of peoples does. But one of the persistent problems with this field of research remains the poor quality of the data. We just don't know enough about individual clerics, especially 18th century ones, to advance yet on the present picture. This is not just a question of their tastes, but also of their incomes, which determined their ability to demand products, and their access to global networks, which determined their access to supply of them. There are also plenty of other global commodities that need researching, and which I've only glossed over in this paper. Coffee is an obvious one. Marcy Norton has identified an intriguing 17th century pamphlet by an anonymous Spaniard, the Carta que escribió un médico cristiano que estaba curando en Antibury a un cardenal de Roma sobre la bebida de caje o café. Norton claims that the author, a Spaniard traveling in the cardinal's retinue while he was visiting the Ottoman Empire, perhaps Palestine, wrote at the request of the prelate about this new drink of coffee. I'm not convinced that 17th century cardinals would have made such a journey into Ottoman lands, but the text merits further investigation. Equally, there are other interesting claims. Joseph Rompel, for example, has speculated that Lugo and Tafur's shared theological interests were what brought them together to exchange cinchona bark. And Saul Jarko has attempted to identify both the different points of sale of cinchona around Rome, which came of this initial exchange, and also who supplied them. In some ways, the broader limitation here is the same as it has been in all the research that I have presented. The existing scholarship is often written by historians of medicine, food, or science, and reflects their research priorities and expertise. Historians of the church have not yet tackled these sorts of topics or used their deeper understandings of ecclesiastical institutions and the Vatican's archival collections to supplement what is now known. It may be that there is nothing more to learn, or at least there is nothing more that reproblematizes the topic and changes the focus of argument. But then again, it could form the basis of a big 5-year research project with plenty of European research funding. So I would welcome your thoughts. Thank you very much.